British Army have got to take the consequences.
Detachment! Right! Wheel!
They crossed the Buffalo River and they went towards the mountain of the Zindwana to make camp. The army was split into three columns, and Lord Chelmsford sent them to look for the enemy. One column was camped at his own one.
Fall in when you're ready.
They thought the enemy was somewhere else. They sent out scouts. And all of a sudden, the enemy was sighted. The British army had been, as usual, underestimating their enemies. They've been fighting in the jungles of southern Africa for about 4 years. They found most of the tribes easy meat. They'd never met the Zulus. An organised army, the like of which had never been come across before. So they camped under the shade of the mountain, thinking they was perfectly safe. Didn't lager their wagons, which they were told to by the Boers, who had previous experience in the Zulus.
Detachment! Take march!
And on the morning of the 22nd, the Zulus came crashing down from the mountains. 24,000 in the impi. All we had in artillery was light field pieces such as these. 7-pounders or 3-pounders. This particular gun is a 3-pound Whitworth. Cutting edge technology of its time. The famous hexagonal bore. They were normally mounting guns, but they recarried them for using on the belt because mounting guns were only packed by mules. But we wanted them around faster, we wanted them horse toes. So they put small barrels on large trails. We've just heard the message. The Zulus have been sighted, coming down from the Drakensberg.
Detachment! Zulu sighted! 1,000 yards!
They will now fire a ranging shot. An explosive projectile known as a Whitworth bolt, cast iron, machined to match the hexagonal bore of the field piece. One of the most accurate systems of the 1860s and 1870s. Loading weapons were tried in the early 1860s, but because of the technology, they couldn't get a decent gas tight breech. So they had to go back to muzzle loaders, such as these chaps are using. The infantry are armed with a 577-450 Martini, the first breech-loading, purpose-made rifle of the British Army. Again, cutting-edge technology of its time. It's a fine weapon. It's an action that is still in use today on most target weapons. The slug was soft leg. Hits you with a smallish hole in the front and could take a hole the size of your fist out of the back. In normal circumstances, the infantry would form the famous British square. But in this particular war, at the beginning, they were so blasé about it all that they lined up in loose ranks, didn't even bother about the square. This was the cause of their downfall. Zulus are getting closer. It's now time for another round.
Attachment! 500 yards!
Procedure is to worm the bore out to get rid of any smoking embers which might set off the next charge prematurely. Once clear, the wet sponge will go. You'll see the vent is covered to prevent any air flows fanning any flames. The wet sponge goes in, followed by the dry sponge. Next part of the procedure, when given the order, will be the powder charge.
Attachment! 200 yards!
Gunner checks the elevation and the traverse.
Ready!
Single shot! Open shell, no!
Then he trots over to the limber, which is kept well at the... The explosives are in the limber. We don't want any sparks from the gun blowing everybody to kingdom come. He will get the charge of powder.
Ready!
And into the loader. Then the projectile is put in, rammed down tight, with a position wad. the ignition is fitted. It can be electric or it can be friction tube.
Gun ready! Fire!
Circling around with the famous horns of the buffalo manoeuvre, standard Zulu tactics. The main army hit with the chest of the buffalo. The horns of the buffalo were the flankers. They would go around the east side and meet around the back until they enveloped the British column. Right, the Zulus are now getting very, very close. So this time we go over to canister shot or case shot, which is basically like a very, very large shotgun shell, lots and lots of musket balls. Very, very good for massed troop formations.
Attachment! 50 yards! Canister shot!
Ready!
No!
Despite all their brave efforts, the army was overcome, and out of nearly 2,000 British troops, Imperial Infantry, Native Auxiliaries and Colonial Cavalry, barely 50 men survived. It was our version of Custer's last stand. Virtually all the artillerymen were killed, and most of the infantry. Split into small sections, numerous last stands. The famous Colonel Durnford, surrounded by his native horse, they died to a man.
Charge! Planet! My God!